What's going on, everyone? I am here with Rachel Miller. She is a global influencer marketing lead at SAP, and she works in influencer marketing with influencers across all different platforms, and we just recorded a couple episodes of the podcast. We had a really great time, and I'm excited to have her here to have a casual conversation. What's up, Rachel?
Hey, Mario. Thanks for having me on your show. It's been so much fun.
Yeah, I've had a blast. We talked about things that are really interesting to me, like influencer, which are also interesting to you, influencer marketing and which platforms to be on and skill sets to use. I mean, I loved our last conversation, I think the most about moderation because, and when I say moderation, I don't mean like doing things in moderation. I mean, being a moderator, yeah, as like a host, because I think it's such a valuable skill set, but I also think that a lot of people take it for granted, like, oh, I'll have a podcast or I'll start a Facebook Live series or an Instagram show or whatever, and I'll just interview people and it's easy because they'll bring the content and it'll make me look like I know them. So by association, it props me up. But there is a real skill set to it.
It truly is. And I don't think we can overemphasize that enough. And I think it can make or break a podcast. I think you can have kind of some underwhelming guests, but if you're a great moderator and a great host, you can make them shine. But the reverse is not true. You can have a great guest and a shitty host and that episode will suck. So yeah. It's a really necessary skill.
It's amazing because, you know, you see people, they think like, oh, I'm going to get Oprah and Tony Robbins and all these people that have all these following and then their followers are going to follow me. And it's like, you could bring someone on, just as you said, who's great and has great content, but if you don't ask the right questions or navigate it in the right place, or it's not even about asking questions, it's about carrying a conversation. And it's about giving that person the space to be who they really are. And, you know, if it is someone who has a big following already, they've probably been on 100 different shows and asked the same questions over and over again. Right. That's why I always like to ask people in my pre-interviews, you know, what's one thing that you're passionate about that you want to talk about, but no one ever asks you about? I always want to know the answer to that. So I'm going to ask you that right now. What's one thing that you'd love to talk about that you would love to, but no one ever asks?
Oh, that's a hard question to ask. Yeah, I think most people are like, oh, so influencer marketing, what's that about? Blah, blah, blah. How'd you get into it? That's super common. What's not common? I guess I know I didn't know much about your past. You mentioned being a chef and broadcast. My background is also very diverse, so it was not a straight line. I actually have a fine arts degree. Mm-hmm. I was a sculpture and drawing major. Influencer marketing was not even a twinkle in some marketer's eye back then. This was in the late 90s. And then my career kind of took a little bit more traditional. I went into graphic design for several years, which then transitioned to SEO, content marketing, and then influencer marketing, which was, I feel really lucky. I was able to kind of grab onto each trend as they were kind of coming up in the marketing world. But that's not often a story I tell. So it's everyone's assumed, because I say I've been doing influencer marketing for the last 8-9 years, they're like, oh, that's a career.
Was there something that led you to that? I mean, to realize that that's a thing and it's something you enjoy and something that you're good at?
I think I realized that I was good at identifying new voices while I was doing content marketing, because that involved collaborating with a lot of bloggers, like getting to know people at various publications. So there was that relationship marketing part, the networking. And I feel influencer marketing is basically the same. You're kind of tracking down who's talking about what, where are they doing it, what's their audience like, and you get to know them before you make your ask. And I think they're kind of one and the same, I think, if people really were to break down what it's all about.
Do you still do things in the fine arts? Do you still have like...
I do. I paint, I think, more often than anything. And I do that with my daughter. I'm trying to get her to be more crafty. So that's something we definitely do together. But yeah, I have a lot of art in my walls. I'm proud to say that it's all for people that I know or myself. But yeah, it's definitely something I try to keep fresh. Art's important.
Nice. Is that like, does it become like a decompression tool for you? Like if you've had a rough day or been very busy and you can just like get in front of the canvas and kind of relax?
No, I think that's what I go to music for. I'll sit down and, you know, have a glass of wine and I'll put on some of my favorite jams. Art, I definitely have to be in the mood or inspired by something, because especially like painting, it could take weeks or months to actually produce the final piece. So it's not, I mean, sometimes you can, like, if it's a simpler design, you can knock it out relatively quickly. But some things, when you're layering, it takes a long time. Plus you have to wait for paint to dry, which is one of the most annoying things about painting. When, especially if you put one coat, then you have to wait. That could take a long time, and I'm not a patient person. So it's, so yeah, it's not a de-stressor. It would be a cause of stress probably.
It's like watching paint dry, right?
Literally. Touching it to see, is it dry yet? Dry yet? Yeah.
What's more gratifying for you, finishing a piece of art or discovering that next influencer that really begins to blow it up?
Definitely discovering the next influencer. Yeah. It's so fulfilling to find someone and, you know, you can see that their passion for their topic sparkle every time they talk about it, or when you can, even when you read it, you can read, hear their voice. And then really coaching them up to grow their network, introducing them to more people that they can collaborate with. That is so much fun, and it's really cool. I think I like helping people do that.
That's awesome. And what's something that's happened to you maybe since, you know, over the course of the last year or whatever, since you've been in the influencer marketing space that really shocked you?
Other than TikTok?
TikTok's a good answer. Do you remember when TikTok used to be Musical.ly?
Yeah.
Do you remember that? And then,
which was the same thing. It was always there, like on the periphery. I was like, oh, that looks interesting.
Yeah. Yeah.
But I never took it seriously. And that's kind of where, I mean, even though I know, like, as I think we shared in one of the episodes, there are some really cool people on TikTok that are doing more of it, taking a more educational slant on a variety of topics versus just the straight up entertainment. And nothing's wrong either way, but it is, I don't know if it says something like where the world's at right now, that we have this like hyper short attention span and we will just watch the most stupid stuff for hours.
Do you think this global lock-in thing is what really made TikTok explode? Do you think that's the timing thing? Because I know TikTok's been there. Like, I look at like my younger cousins and, you know, the kids in my family, and they're like, TikTok was their thing. And, you know, it, Snapchat had a minute, then Instagram stories took it over, and then TikTok. And so I knew it was a thing, and I knew the younger generation was there, but now I'm starting to see a lot of 30 plus, 40 plus, 50 plus people. And, you know, it's gotta be a timing thing, right? Cause it's not super unique, the format. I mean, Vine was there, which was very similar. Snapchat was even similar, aside from TikTok, it like stays there. So, I mean, it's not like it's a totally new concept. It's just a different platform.
Yeah. And I think timing has had a lot to do with the success of many social platforms. I also feel influencers. I think that especially when you pair timing with certain people, you know, the TikTok stars right now, like, I don't know what their futures hold, but they're killing it right now. So I definitely feel it also, like, you know, children, like younger people, where they're being homeschooled, they have a lot more free time to stay on their devices than they were if they were going off to school. So I think that's definitely fueling it. But they were all kind of gravitating towards it. Even myself, I've learned some really weird how to make household cleaning supplies out of really strange things.
would you rather be TikTok famous or Instagram famous?
Oh, hands down Instagram.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, because I think TikTok is going to be like, there's your, you know, 5 seconds of fame. But Instagram, you know, when they say picture lasts forever, whatever that saying is. So I think it has more longevity for sure.
Where do you think, and I know you don't like it, I know you're not a big fan, we talked about this in an episode of Facebook, but where do you think that's going? Like, what do you think that's valuable for in today's influencer world? Because what I see is the pages, the Facebook business pages, the organic reach is so low. It's like, if you want to reach people via a business page, you have to pay for it and boost it. You know, if you use your personal profile, now you can't do as much business on it, but you have to use the follow feature because you can only have 5. So it seems like there's a lot of hoops to jump through. Now, the advertising product is still pretty good, even though it's becoming saturated. It still hasn't gotten overly expensive and the targeting's gotten better. But where do you think Facebook sits among the TikToks, the Instagrams, the Snapchats, the LinkedIns of the world?
Okay, so yes, I'm generally not a fan of the platform. due to, I feel it's, of all the social networks, I find it to be really negative. Mm-hmm. What I do love and I see big potential for is Facebook groups. Mm-hmm. I belong to one that's about cooking. There's a couple of fitness ones I belong to. There's some business ones that I pay to be in. Very valuable. And I think that's where you can kind of sidestep that organic reach because you have your captive audience. They're choosing to be there. They are notified every time you post something. And there's some really great conversations happening. The platform as a whole, I think, has done more damage than good, especially going through, you know, the political things we're going through. Now the global pandemic. How quickly fake news, bad news, generally negative ranting goes viral. And then you see it over and over again if you happen to engage, and then it's just all you see. So then you're stuck in this little bubble of nonsense. So I wish that there was a way for them to correct that. But a lot of that, I think, is just the types of users that are drawn to it are kind of, that's their jam. So it's kind of like, that's their happy place. It's not mine. But groups, I love the groups.
Yeah, that's a good point. Facebook groups are a great feature. And there's, I think Facebook is the one who did groups right, because I think LinkedIn tried to do groups. It didn't really go over that well. The other platforms just aren't set up really for groups. I mean, Twitter has like lists, but it's not the same thing. So I think Facebook groups is the best product like that, where you can create a closed-in ecosystem around a certain topic and have people raise their hand and opt in to be part of that. So I'll agree with that 110%, but there's something about Twitter that always brings me back. There's something that's like almost addicting about the Twitter feed.
Twitter was my first love. I was a really early adopter to Twitter, and it is still up there. I would go, like, Instagram would be my number one, and then I would say Twitter is number two. One, it's so easy to find people with the whole the hashtags, love hashtags. I like that even though they've increased the character limit over the years, it still is relatively short compared to other platforms. And I like that it forces people to be very concise in how they share knowledge. And if you can't say it in that many, you know, 280 characters, you don't know enough about that topic. So it's one of my pet peeves with, I love Twitter chats. We produce a lot of them, I participate in them, but when people do their answers and there's like a four-part answer, I'm like, really? You should have had a blog post prepared. Because I really feel if you are an expert on a certain thing, you should be able to say it in a way that people are like, oh, uh-huh, I totally get it, in that character space.
Wasn't it Albert Einstein that said a real genius can take complex things and make them simple? Any idiot can take something simple and make it complicated. I think that was a similar
point. And
that
actually relates back to our discussion about moderators and what the characteristics of a great moderator. That is another thing, because you mm-hmm. can, you know, take something, we can have an expert on a really complex topic, but if you can kind of break it down into layman's terms to where, you know, a 10-year-old child would understand it, that is a skill. Mm-hmm. Building out the whole moderator persona right now.
One of the things about that, about learning complex skills, I remember one of the best explanations I heard on that was Tony Robbins explaining that. And he said, you know, he was talking about like business negotiations and like sitting down with someone and having like, if you're building a building, say, and an architect coming in and explaining all the different nuances of building it. And he's like, I don't understand that, but I understand this orange. So pretend this orange is the building. Now explain it to me using the orange. And then you learn right away because you know you can reference something that you already understand. And I think that's a big part of it too. When you're having those conversations, thinking about the audience and knowing they're all at different places, doing different things, maybe multitasking as well. So let's use something we all understand. I think everyone knows what an orange is or something like that. Let's take it back there and let's, you know, explain it that way and make it simpler. I think that's like a valuable way to kind of perceive things and learn faster, so to speak.
For sure. When you can put it into context that everybody can relate to, then they grasp mm-hmm. it so much faster. And otherwise, you're just talking about crazy things that nobody knows.
Yeah, exactly. And I hear a lot of people put emphasis on storytelling, because that's why people love Netflix, right? Ever since the beginning of time, we've been sitting around campfires telling stories. That was the first Netflix, right? Tribes sitting around telling stories. And storytelling is such a powerful, powerful tool. But I think that it's been talked about so much by so many people at various skill sets and levels or whatever, that's kind of losing its luster. Whereas it's just not, there's so many people doing it ineffectively that it's almost hampering the people who are doing it effectively, if that makes sense.
Definitely. And I think that is kind of a differentiation perhaps between, so you have storytellers and then you, I guess you can say we have creators. You have people who are very skilled at using software applications, you know, the native platform functionalities. But if you don't have that storytelling layer, you're just showing people cool features. You're not actually making it a human interesting thing where we can relate to and go, oh, aha, uh-huh, I want to learn more from you. Because, and that might be, maybe you kind of drill down on why we're seeing so much crappy content.
That might be it. That sounds, yeah, that sounds interesting. And the other reason we have so much crappy content, I think it's magnified right now because everyone's at home and bored. So everyone's trying to make content. And, you know, when you have people who've never made content before, of course, it's going to take time for them to figure out what's valuable. And people, they're probably just doing it for fun. They haven't thought about their audience, but that does murky the waters for the people who are really trying to create stuff that's really special and connect with people at a deeper level.
Absolutely. So that actually, that triggered a question for me, for you. Okay. So everyone's like, you have to do video, you have to do video. And I'm kind of the opinion that you don't, because not everybody is great on camera. And I think we're forcing people to do it when I'm just like, you know what? You stick to podcasts or you stick to blogging. So I'd be really curious to know what you think about that.
I agree with you 110%. And I tell, you know, clients that all the time. For me, it's about content consumption. That's what it's always about, because it goes back to that old saying, if a tree falls in the forest and no one's around, does it really make a sound? Well, I always ask, if you create the best piece of content that ever existed and no one consumes it, does it really exist? So for me, it's like there are two major places where people consume long form content. And that's through audio, because they can do it as they multitask, and through reading, whether it be books, blogs, whatever, because people are just wired to read. And again, you can read while you're sitting in your cubicle, you can read without interrupting other people. So reading and audio are the two major pieces. Video is important to get attention, in my opinion. So if you can create short video clips, 2 minutes or less, to grab someone's attention and then navigate them to where they can consume long form, that's very valuable. But to put out a 30, 40 minute video, I don't think you can hold someone's attention that long. But if you look at the numbers from a podcasting perspective, a piece of audio that's 30 minutes or less on a podcast on average gets consumed 88%. That's a pretty big number. So someone will give you 30 minutes of audio time before they decide whether this content is worth continuing to listen to or not. So if you create content that's less than 30 minutes, but very powerful, you can get a huge amount of consumption. Video, on the other hand, if you look at Facebook Live, the last set of data I read says, everyone's talking about you got to do Facebook Live, right? Well, they say that the average watch time of a Facebook Live video is 12 seconds.
12 seconds.
12 seconds. And then someone, and now if it's exceptional content, or if it's someone that's a mega celebrity, they'll watch longer. But most of us aren't exceptional celebrities, and most of the content we create for Facebook Live isn't exceptional. So my thing is, get someone's attention really fast through video, but then push them into somewhere where they'll consume long form. Whether it's a blog post, a book they want to get, an ebook, an audio book, a podcast, get them somewhere where they'll consume, because that's where relationships are built. When someone listens to my podcast on a regular basis, the chances of them reaching out and having a real conversation with me or feeling like we know each other are way better than if they see a 10-second video that I post to TikTok. So it's that relationship building. So to me, video isn't essential unless you're someone like Gary Vee, Tony Robbins, Oprah. Those are people that will command your attention for long periods of time just because of who they are, right, and who they associate with. Like if I had, you know, Jim Carrey on my show, people would sit and watch that for an hour because it's Jim Carrey. Not for me. Maybe it's the way I moderate, but it's Jim Carrey. So I mean, that's the difference. Unless you're an A-list or have an A-list, I don't think video is that vital. It's vital to put it out there so people put a face to the name and to guide them to where long-form content lives. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, I know. I agree with everything you've said. And I think it's just knowing where you're going to shine. Because I think if you don't feel comfortable on camera, stop forcing yourself to do it, because we can see you.
Yeah.
And that vibe is coming across. So yeah, that's what I tell people, because they're like, I'm getting pressured to do video. And I'm like, if you truly don't want to, don't.
Right. I think the other question that's really powerful for people to ask is, when I put this piece of content out there and it's consumed, what is it like to the consumer? Because when we post content, we like it because we made it. But at the end of the day, what is it you want that consumer to feel from that content? Because there's lots of times that I'll create a post or create something, and then I'll read it from the perspective of the consumer, and I go, this isn't kind of getting what I want. So I'm just going to like not post that. And I think that most people post too willy-nilly off the cut. They just do it. They don't take the time to think, what's the actual consumer going to feel when they read this?
I agree. But I do feel that we have shifted to more quality over quantity over the last couple of years. So I know people were blogging on the daily. I'm like, one, who has time to read your blog every day? And yeah, then you get to the end and there's no CTA. Like you're like, I didn't really even learn anything. So yeah, I think we need to be a lot more deliberate and thoughtful when we're creating content, especially now, because there's so much out there. You don't want to be a cause of, don't be a part of the problem.
Exactly. But to take it back full circle again to what we talked about before, I think that if you know your platform where you shine the most, if you know that place where you put, and I always use the 80-20 rule, 80% of your time where it's the most effective, and then 20% spread out across everything else. For me, podcasting is my jam. So I spend 80% or more of my time in the podcast space. But I know that the content, because I've done it for so long and I like it so much and I'm so good at it, I put out episodes 6 days a week. They're short, but they're 6 days a week and they're packed with punch, I feel. And so I feel like it's quantity and quality in that space. Now, the other platforms, I'm very cognizant of, what am I posting? What's the purpose of this? How is this going to go? But I feel confident enough in the podcast space for myself, as I use that as an example, that I can go 6 days a week or more and still put out stuff that's valuable for people to keep them coming back. So if you have a jam that you find, your zone of genius, I think that you can be both quantity and quality in that space. And you should be, so you cut through a lot of that noise. Because if you're putting out a quality product in quantity, then it'll cut through the noise more than if you just pace yourself.
True. Yeah. Knowing your audience and the cadence, I think is really important. I like that you've chosen like a more of a snackable, use a buzzword, snackable content. But I think that it's hyper effective. And yeah, I think when you've gotten it worked out, you know your jam, you can definitely have a balance of it.
Yeah, I agree. Well, Rachel, thank you so much. I appreciate everything you shared on the podcast and here. I know we went a little long, but I love the conversation. It was so much fun. I want to remind people they can connect with you on Twitter and LinkedIn. And you're on Instagram too. That's kind of your place, right? We'll link that up. And again, thank you. And let's do it again real soon.
Definitely. Look forward to it.